Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. We are praising you now in your house. We love to be in the house of the Lord. And we are here because of you. You gather us together from different corners of the earth. Such a diversity group of people. But now we are yours. And because of your blood, we are one. We are church. We are your body and we are family. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. And I pray right now, use me. Use everything what's inside of me to bring the word of God. Because of this word, faith would be built. Faith would be born. I'm praying right now for everyone, for every single person in this auditorium, for their families they represent, for their circle of friends. God, we are here because we want you to move in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. Wow. Such a privilege to be here. Thank you so much for having me and my husband. And I'm not a preacher in my family. He is the one. My husband, he's a great preacher. So it's funny to me, for me, because when we travel, people ask me to preach, but back in my church, I hardly preach. I do everything else. I do dishes, I do chairs, I do children's ministry, I do creative team, media team, like I lead worship, everything, and he just preach because he's such a great preacher. But I guess when I got a chance to travel the world, God just wants to use both of us to show one body, one flesh. And God wants to show he can use anyone, male, female, doesn't matter what age. So I'm not nervous, but I'm very, I want God to use me. Because I want you to receive from God, not from me. And it's true, this is not my language. English language is not my language. When people are saying, Viera is preaching and her second language, I love because my first language, my native language is Ukrainian. I was raised during Soviet Union time, so back then they forced Russian language. So I'm thinking in Russian. And English language I never studied. 25 years ago, I could hardly understand anything in English. But I believe God can give you a gift. So I believe God gave us a gift of the language. You know, it says in the Bible, God would give you the gift of languages. And they would be heavenly languages, but they would be earthly languages. So people could understand you. So you could share your faith with them. You know, our life is a journey. People are often saying, have you heard about this? Your life is a journey. Okay, people are often saying this, but you know, this journey, like my journey, I did not finish my journey yet, but still, like, I understand I'm going to the second part of my life. And I'm a grandma of four. Can you believe that? I don't know how this happened. But when I got saved, I was reading this book, and by the way, in our country, we never get any Christian resources. So someone would give us a Bible, we would read it. Someone gave us this tape, we would sing this song. And someone translated this book called Pilgrim's Progress by John Bunyan. Have you heard about this book? This book was translated into Russian language under the name of Pilgrim's Journey. And it's a book about the guy named Christian and about his journey toward heaven. And I remember when I was reading this book, I could identify myself with him because I thought, I'm on a journey to heaven as well. I gave my heart to Jesus. So I'm moving toward heaven and all of you sitting here, we are following his example. We do the same. Our life is a journey and our destination is heaven, not the grave. But sometimes this journey could be glamorous. We would have sunny moments, but sometimes it would be darkness or we would experience storm. When I was reading in the book of Genesis, the story about Joseph. When he was a little boy, he got these dreams and from God. What he will do in life, but it was a journey. And on his journey to this fulfillment of his dream, he was going to prison, he was betrayed, he was sold into slavery by his own brothers. Anyway, he ended up fulfilling God's purpose in his life, and he was saving his family from Egypt. Do you remember the story when he saved his family from starvation? And he brought this family, and Egypt Pharaoh asked Joseph's father, Jacob, how old are you? What's your age? And I like Jacob's response. He said, Genesis 47, verses 8 and 9. Pharaoh asked Jacob, how old are you? And Jacob said to Pharaoh, the days of the years of my pilgrimage are 130 years. You know, Jacob viewed his life as a journey. So we should view our lives the same. We should do the same, because 1 Peter, 1st chapter, verses 17, 18, it says, you call out to God for help and he helps because he is a good father. He is a good father that way, but don't forget, he is also a responsible father. And he won't let you get by sloppy living. When I read the Bible, when I started to read the Bible, remember, I was not raised in church. I did not know any traditions. I did not know how it's supposed to be. And when missionaries came to our country, it was hundreds of us. And only one pastor who could speak English, he could hardly talk to each one of us. So he would say, you know what, I don't have anyone to talk to you about faith. Take your Bible and read it for yourself. So we grew up eating this food. And when you read this, even this is enough. So I remember I read this. Your father won't let you get by with sloppy living. And the Message Bible actually saying your life is a journey. You must travel with a deep consciousness of God. You must say, I must. So when you travel in life toward heaven, it's not just about destination. It's about the process as well. We cannot live sloppy. We cannot live without thinking what God thinks about our journey. We need to know that we should be different. Our life, our journey should be different. People who look at us, they should say, what's up with you? Like, people are saying at my life, they're saying, you are crazy. I remember my friends, they said, you are crazy. Why did you throw out all your musical career now to become what? Priest? Who you are? What are you going to do with your life? What about your education? They did not know God would use my musical, not just ability, but my musical knowledge to influence with not just music, but God's music. Millions and millions of people. I did not throw it away. I just started to use what I've got for my journey. I travel a lot. When I was a little girl, I was dreaming to travel, but during Soviet Union, you would not go far. I grew up in a small city, but these days I'm so blessed to be able to travel a lot, and people around me probably they think, oh, how lucky Vera is, because she traveled to other countries. But even in my wildest dream, I would not dream I would be in America, standing in this awesome church in California, preaching in English. Can you believe that? How crazy is that? It was beyond my wildest dream. When we study in the Bible college, you know, God did quick work with us. We get saved. Less than a year, we go to Bible college. 2 years in the Bible college. Jenya graduated Saturday. Sunday, they lay hand on him. He became pastor. Less than 5 years saved. I said, we did not even read whole Bible yet. How can we be pastors? And our pastor, who came from actually Hillsong Australia Church, he said, "Oh, you will be just fine. Bye." You got the Bible? No, we asked him, what should we do? Like, we don't know what to do. He said, if you don't know what to do, just pray. It's a good advice. Read your Bible and pray. But when we were reading in the Bible college about Apostle Paul, by the way, you understand my English, okay? Yeah, okay. Apostle Paul and his mission trips. Oh, now he's sailing to Greece. Now he's going to Italy. Look at this. I would love to travel like Apostle Paul. And sometimes we look at pastors and preachers and teachers and missionaries and we say, oh, how glamorous it is. But do you know they don't travel as tourists? There is a difference. They don't travel to explore something like Christopher Columbus or Marco Polo. They travel to explore someone with a capital S. They travel to know someone and his will. There is a difference. It's another kind of journey. I remember a few years back, Zhenya and I visited Melbourne in Australia. Melbourne is a city called Melbourne. But we were visiting Melbourne in a different occasions. So Zhenya would fly by himself. He was preaching at the church there, and I was there doing women's conference. And we were talking to each other, and I asked him, do you like Melbourne? He said, you know, it's hard to say because I was flying in, they took me from airport, they drive me to church, I preach, they take me back to the car, they bring me back to the airport. I was flying back to Sydney, I was preaching there a few times, then I flew to Brisbane, and it was a weekend. So he said, I have not seen Melbourne. I said, it's funny, but I've been there for 3 days. I flew in, they took me from airport, they brought me to the conference, and it was like conference, hotel, airport, and I have not seen Melbourne either. And people would say, oh, how lucky you are. You were at Melbourne. It's good when you can combine your mission trips with a purpose, with some leisure and with some sightseeing. But very often it's not like this. So when we travel, our primary goal is to fulfill the will of our Savior. So now we're gonna start a church. We already started a church in Miami. We moved to Miami 2 weeks ago, and people, especially people in Russia and Ukraine, it's very cold in our country. So they would say, oh, how lucky you are. You are in Miami now. Miami. And we moved to Miami. We were there whole week. And I said to my husband, did you notice, like, we did not even went to the beach once? Because we were so busy, we were moving to an apartment, we were doing all the documents. We got 9 people to move from Ukraine, and our first grandson, he's a first grader, we need to find school for him. And here you need to turn electricity because your apartment, it doesn't have electricity. And lots of things, all is new. We were so preoccupied with the work we're supposed to do in our new mission field. We completely forgot we are in Miami. We are sitting in the room. And the reason I am telling you this, because sometimes we look at people in the ministry or we look at other Christians and we're saying, what a journey. But we don't understand how much people pay for that kind of journey. And believe me, this journey is glorious. I would not trade it to anything. But during this journey, when we sail toward heaven, we do have storms. So when Paul, he sailed to Italy. Let's read about this. Acts chapter 27, verse 1. And then it was decided that we should sail to Italy. Oh, how romantic. It was decided we would just sail to Italy. Last night, after the amazing conference, you know, we got a chance to sit and laugh and eat and talk with your pastors. And we were dreaming about short-term vacation together to Florida because it's unbelievable. They've never been to Florida. What's up with that? You should go. It's a beautiful place. We did not check a beach yet, but they told it's nice. And you are sitting and talking, especially about kids. You should bring them, so we will combine all our kids and we will go to Disney at least for 1 or 2 days. Let's do short-term together time. And I remember Dan said, but if I go to Florida and people would know I'm there, they would ask me to preach and it's not going to be vacation anymore. I would not see anything, which is like, it's true. So don't worry, we're not going to tell anyone. It's going to be completely secret service mission. So when Apostle Paul decided to go to Rome, he did not plan to go to vacation. Paul knew this trip got a purpose. No, it was not to explore Italy, but to discover God's will, preach the gospel to Rome, in Rome to the Caesar, and he knew it's the last trip, and he will die there for the gospel. That trip was difficult. That trip was long. Trip like this require faith. To live with a mission and to have a journey toward heaven, it will have different seasons, different situations. And when we read about Paul's trip in Acts chapter 27, we can see such words like difficulty, dangerous, disaster, much loss. And I'm not trying to scare you, because if you're a person of faith, if you're a believer, these words are not going to scare you. They're going to fire you up, just fire you up, because you know in the end of the day, you will conquer all of this. And then it was a storm. It's so interesting, like today we saw the opener, and it says, remind me, the storm, like, the storm will be sent to you, but the warrior answer, I'm the storm. Actually, the name of our fourth grandchild, his name is Storm. Romeo Jaden Storm. I don't know what's up with that, but... Ship was caught by the wind and waves. Nothing they can do to stop the storm, nothing they can do. And they decided just let it drive. Let her drive. Whatever happens, happens. And sometimes our life is like that ship. Somewhere in our journey, we are caught by the storm. Strong wind, circumstances, tragedy. And we are ready to let it drive. When you're going to read Acts chapter 27, verse 20, it says, now, when neither sun nor stars appeared for many days, and no small tempest beat on us, all hope that we would be saved was finally given up. Everyone on that ship gave up hope. Everyone except one. It says in the Bible, Paul, he was a different person. So you know, when we are going through situations, and on our journey we do have circumstances, obstacles, we should react differently. It's a huge temptation to react like other people. Ah! You know what Paul said? Paul said, don't lose hope. Paul ignited hope in them even when they lost their hope completely. One person was enough to ignite hope in everyone on that ship. It's true. Then fearing least, verse 29, we should run aground on the rocks. They dropped 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for the day to come. You know, our life is a journey and we are sailing toward heaven. And during our journey, sometimes sun is shining and all is well. And we are singing, this is well with my soul, something like this. It's so easy to sing this as well with my soul when everything is well. But during this storm, they are ready to die. Do you think it was easy for them to sing this is well with my soul? You know, story ended very well. They survived. But they could easily be killed. They could crush themselves on those rocks. But what they did, they put anchors. They put anchors around them, four of them. There is a verse in the Bible which I love very much. And this one which I heard long before I was saved. Even during Soviet Union, people did not read Bible, but they were quoting Bible because generation before, they would tell it as a wisdom, but actually it was a Bible. So 1 Corinthians 13:13 it says, and now abide faith, hope, love, these three. It is so important for us to know what to do when we are in the middle of the storm, in order not to experience shipwreck of our faith. And it says here, three abides. Not just faith, not just love, but hope as well. So I got another 15 minutes to share with you my life experience about faith, hope, and love. Because this saved me so many times on my journey. This verse is very special to me for many reasons, but one of the main reasons, my name Vera means faith. In the Russian language, Vera means faith. My dad could not have children for 10 years. He was waiting for his firstborn to be born. And in desperation, his mother, because my dad was her only child, his mother, my grandma, turned to God. She did it secretly. She found this nun, very, very old lady. She was almost 100 years of age. During Soviet time, this nun was sent to Siberia. But when she was old, they allowed her to go back to Ukraine so she would peacefully die in her own land. She was poor. She was wearing all black, very old. So my grandma turned to this nun and asked her, "Can you please pray for my son?" And this lady, she was praying, and she said, "Your son will have a daughter. You need to name her Faith. And it will be three girls. So name second one Hope, and then Love." That's how, during atheistic time, they gave me name Faith, which is very strange and unusual. Otherwise, I would be Natasha. Yes, my mom gave birth to three girls, Faith, Hope, and Julia. My parents divorced after Hope. And my mom remarried, and third girl, Julia, was born in another marriage. Yes, and this is sad. You know what's sad? It's sad when people take the word of God just religiously. They could put cross, they could take icons, they could even claim the word of God, but if faith, hope, and love, they are not inside of you, we're not going to sail to heaven, toward heaven with success till the end. So you see, my name was Faith, and I was like, my name was Faith, and I did not believe in God. So it doesn't matter what you say outside, what's inside matter. In churches, we can hear a lot about faith, and a lot about love, but not so many messages about hope. In fact, we don't speak about hope often. And I will give you a little example, and I pray you will remember this example, because this example will show you why we don't speak about hope as often. So we need three of them, remember. All of them important, three abides. So number one, faith, it's like our sail. This is our key to start a journey with God. We cannot start a journey with God. We cannot sail toward heaven without faith. Faith will be that seed for our salvation. Faith will move us as far as we believe. And if you're going to show a picture, oh, it's a lot of a picture here. Sail. If you don't have a sail, sometimes we are saying, why God is not moving? God is moving all the time. He cannot still stay still. He is moving. He just need your sail to be able to move you. And this sail is your faith. Sail is a large piece of clothes on the top of some boats. Mostly it's white color. I'm not that smart, I just found it in Wikipedia. The wind goes around the sail and makes the boat move through the water. God, with his breath, will move us only when we got sail. When he is breathing, do you have a sail to cope with his breath? The piece that the sail is attached to is called a mast. Some boats have many sails and some have only one. Usually small boats have only one sail and bigger boats have more. Can you show us the picture of the sail with many, boat with many sails? Sometimes people are saying, why do we need church? I have God, I have faith. Okay, let me tell you something. If you are thinking about yourself, maybe one sail is enough. But if you are thinking about the world, church is simply like a big ship where big mast has many sails. What about nations? To reach them, you're not going to do it by your own. I love the fact your church does not just call Rock Church. It's called World Outreach. To reach the world, you need a ship with many sails. And we don't need just people to come here without faith, you know. All of us are supposed to have our sail up when we enter this auditorium. And we should say, add my sail. Add my sail to this boat so we can go further. And we can achieve more. Combined faith, united faith, will see unimaginable and unbelievable. That's why I love the church. Because only big sheep can reach the world. Number two, love is like our banner. This is our flag. And when you see the boat and you see a huge flag, immediately you know whom this boat represents. Like, you don't need to guess twice. Is this boat American? No. How do you know that? Because of the flag. A banner is a flag or other piece of clothes bearing a symbol, logo, or slogan, or message. People around us, they need to know who we are, whom we represent, and they need to benefit from our lives. Our banner is love. Our message is love. Yes, we move by faith, but Jesus himself, he said, just one thing will show the world you are my disciple, and this is love. And sometimes as Christians, you know, we are so aiming to the goal and we are ready to move and just step over the heads of people, push everyone because we wanted to achieve something. We've got faith and God said, no, it's not enough. Three needs to abide. Can you move forward without losing love? Without sacrificing love? Because sometimes as Christians, we are so focused, we could go with the pirate banner, black one. We acting like we want to take more than to give more. I do appreciate your pastors. And I appreciate they've got big, huge faith. But do you know what? Oh, how I appreciate they are people of love. This is the most important thing, which is as important as our sail. So we got faith, we got love. So what's up with hope? Do you know hope? Why do we need hope? We get sail to move and flag right in the middle of our boat. It's visible to everyone. But now, look at this anchor. Look at this anchor. Hope hanging somewhere on the side. Not that attractive, not that pretty, this ugly, scary, heavy anchor. Most of the time it's under the water when we stay. It doesn't look attractive at all. And we don't preach about hope often because we need hope in the most darkest hours, in the most difficult situations. Believe me, when storm come and your sail and your flag is not able to cope, You can feel that your faith is disappearing and your love is weak. That's why your anchor, hope, will save you. Hold on, stay firm, don't move if you cannot. But most importantly, stay on course. Stay on course. Don't give up your journey just because you are in the middle of the storm. So this story we are reading, Acts chapter 27, and Paul is saying, okay, guys, don't lose hope. And actually, Hebrews 6:19, it says, this hope we have as an anchor of the soul. I love history. I love to read books. And I was researching the first anchors. And you know what? First anchors, they were rocks. Big, huge rocks. They would throw these rocks. So they, during the situation like they need to stay, rocks would hold them. They threw four anchors. How many anchors do you need? As many as you need. From every side just to hold you, to save you. And they were praying for the day to come. So still, stay still until you see the little glimpse of light. About 5 years ago, I started to feel pain in my back. And you know, I was always very active. When I lead worship, I jump. Like, I just turned 40. And I could not imagine, like, this is unfair. I'm such a faith person. So I did not show to my congregation I'm in pain. I was still leading worship. But back at home, I could not move. For almost 9 months, I was sleeping on the floor. Actually, I did not sleep because I could not sleep. At night, pain was unbearable. I started to take medication. I did everything. I was doing physiotherapy. I was trying everything I could. But pain was even more, like, getting stronger. And I felt, I said to my husband, like, I'm becoming a drug addict. I cannot live without these painkillers. So we're supposed to do something. And I remember how I felt. And maybe this would help you. I felt so guilty being a pastor. I felt guilty. What about my faith? I should press on. I just need to move forward. But I could not move. And I remember this message saved me. God showed me, if you cannot move, throw at as many anchors as you need, but stay firm. This is not your fault. You are in the middle of the storm. And if it's dark and you cannot see the light, stay. This will finish. Storm will not be forever. This ugly season and this ugly anchor hope, my trust in God, saved me, brought me closer to God. And you know, my story ended up well. Yes, I didn't get well, so I did the surgery and I'm well. Sometimes you need to help, the help from the doctors. It's okay. I'm fine. I'm still leading worship. I'm still preaching. But the most important thing, I'm still on my journey toward heaven. The same thing happened with Paul. Story ends well. They were saved because one person also has hope. Faith, hope, and love. Maybe you're sitting here and your ship is shaking. You need hope. Maybe waves are so strong. You need hope. Maybe you hit by the storm, but you need hope. When I look, we were visiting Milan, and I saw this beautiful statue of Bartholomew. I don't know how you call him in English. They took his skin, like he's standing there, it's a monument. He's standing there without a skin and he's holding his skin in his hands. And it's not a made up story, it was a reality. All 12 disciples, they died because of the gospel. And I was thinking, so what? What they have hope for? But their hope out of this world, they would send us a message and they would say to us, we know that we are not bodies with souls. We are souls who happens to have bodies. When we lose our bodies, we are not lost ourselves. And I told you I love history. And I was reading about these first graves, graves of Christians. They did not put crosses on their graves like we are doing these days. They put anchors. And those anchors would be the message to the world, we are not dead. We do have hope in God. Even when our body are dead, we are not dead. We are alive forever. Our hope is our resurrection in Jesus' name. Hold on to this no matter what. Because still, you know what? Our goal is heaven. And no one will take this away from you. We do have this hope. Amen? Amen? Our family, our grandmothers, grandfathers, my grandma, my dad, they went to be with the Lord, but they lived whole life during communist regime without knowing God. And we decided we're going to share the gospel with them because we want to have this hope. Even if their body will die, we will see them in heaven. And I remember when my father died, I was sad. I was sad, but I was glad. It's a mixed emotion. I was sad he is not here, but I was glad he is there. Because I've got this hope, and this is my anchor. And today, while I'm sharing with you, maybe you're not going to remember much, but you will remember the ship with sail, with banner, and with anchor. Maybe it's very simple illustration, but these three you would keep in your heart, and you will end your journey with God in the hands of Jesus. This is worth the journey. Would you agree with me? Can we all stand, please? I'm going to pray right now because I know maybe in this auditorium there are some people, amazing, beautiful people who don't even think about the future or eternity. I was like that. I was 21. I was so young. I never knew life would fly like this and one day I would be a grandma. And now I'm thinking about people who are just so busy with their life. They don't even know what's going to happen with their soul because our bodies will die. That's a good news for you. But I've got a better news. You are not your bodies. You are not your bodies. Your soul, that's who you are. And your soul will live forever. So it's very important to have hope. Hope in resurrection of Jesus Christ. Faith in resurrection. And in the Bible it says, he was on a cross, he died. But he came back to life. And he's supposed to be the first one. And we would follow his example. We would follow him. This is what I believe for. My faith is not in a death. My faith is in the resurrection. I am planning to live forever and I know I will. What about you, my friend? What about your soul? You need to have faith, hope, and love. And Jesus came to this earth to take away your sins, to pay the price. 25 years ago, someone came to my country and shared the gospel with me. And the only reason I did not stop just being a normal person, I become like an abnormal Christian woman who would think about the world, who would pray about the world. It's scary. But you know, I would rather do it afraid. Tell people about Jesus. Tell people about salvation. Tell people about heaven and hell. Because the good news is, no one needs to go to hell. Heaven was created for you and for me for eternity. And God loves you so much. And I know it sounds weird from the person who was raised to be atheist, but maybe God wants to use me today to tell you, my friend, it's not enough to be born in a Christian country. I was not born in a Christian country, and look, I became a Christian. And the Word of God changed my life, changed my perspective. So right now, maybe God is using me to tell you, my friend, it's not enough just believe in God. Because many people believe in God. Even my grandma believes in God. But it does not stop them to live sinful life. You need to repent. And you need to say, Dear Lord Jesus, I'm a sinful person. I need a salvation. Thank you that you died for me on that cross. And I so believe you rose again from the dead. And grave is empty. I've been there in Israel. I checked it. It's empty. He is not there. He is now waiting for you and for me. The only reason I'm still there because I got a job to do. I need to do my journey on this earth so as many people as possible would join me in this journey toward heaven. And maybe today it's you, my friend, my dear sister, my dear brother. I call you my sister, I call you my brother because you are. You just don't know it yet. God created you in His image, and you are beautiful. You are amazing. The only sin stop you from God, from a relationship with Him, is your sin, and you doesn't need it. Just put it away. Give your sins to Jesus, because He said, I will take this away and I will give you life. Life is abundance. Yes, you will have storms. You will have tribulation. But in the middle of the storm, I will be there. This storm will just teach you how to stay strong, how to keep your hope and faith and love. And you know what? As everyone on this earth, we are going through a difficult time, but we are not alone anymore. So can I pray for you and with you? Let us all bow down our heads. And please pray for people who are going to enter eternity. I'm praying for the open gates right now. I'm praying for people who will enter eternity with a clean heart, new heart. In Jesus' name I pray, doesn't matter what you did in your life. You know what? Jesus said you will start a new life. Everything what was old, it will go on away. On a cross, He paid the price so you can live free. No guilt, no shame, no death. You will live forever. You will enjoy your life here on this earth. You will live with a purpose. Your journey will satisfy you and you will go to heaven to Jesus. So if you are this person, please, no one is watching, just raise your hand because I want to pray with you. Just raise your hand up high so I can see who you are. Thank you so much. You can put it down. Yes, I saw your hands. I saw your hands, mister. Yes, 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 my sister, I saw your hands. Yes. Who else? Who else? Many people all around there. Amazing. This is amazing. It's not too late. It's not too late to do this. Thank you. Thank you. You can put down your hand. I can see it. I see it. I see it. But the most important thing, God sees it. Please, Pastor Dan and Jess, can you please come up to the stage? Because I really want you to pray with these amazing people. I'm just visiting you. And I love to bring people to Christ. But you are real shepherds who would shepherd them. And this is amazing church. Great church. Great church. Can you please pray?
Yes, I'd like to pray with those of you that have raised your hands, or maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you should have. If you want to be included in this prayer right now, I want to pray with you, and I want to get you down here, okay? And so if you would, just slip out of your seat, get your stuff, get in the aisle, and meet me right up in front. If you want to be included in this prayer, just come on right now. Let's give them a hand as they come, and you just make your way to the front right now. Come on. Come on, let's pray together. Let's pray together. They're coming. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment. Come on. Come on, come on. Come on, you can come too. Even if you didn't raise your hand, you can come right now. Come on, they're still coming. They're still coming. This is your time. This is your moment. Anybody else, if you need to come, come on. Come on. From the family rooms, if your children raise their hand, bring them. They will remember this. Come on, come on, come on. From the family rooms on this side, from the foyer, if you're watching by television, come on in. This is your time. This is your moment. Oh, they're still coming. Come on. Come on. Let's give them a hand. You can come too. They're still coming. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We'll wait for you. Anybody else, if you need to come, just make your way to the front right now. All right, here's what we're going to do, everybody. Thank God you came to give God all your heart, came to give God all of your life. You're going to be born again right here, right now. I'm going to lead you in a short, simple prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You don't get saved just by raising your hand. You get saved when you invite Jesus in. He's a gentleman, okay? And so you're going to invite him in. I'm going to pray simple phrases. Now listen, if you mess up on a couple words, that's okay. This is not about the words of your mouth. This is about the attitude of your heart, okay? Everybody's going to join in with you to encourage you in your faith. And if you should have been up here and you're saying, man, I really should have gone. I should have missed out. Listen, you can pray right there in your seat, right where you're at, all over the world watching on the live stream right now, wherever you're at. If you raised your hand there in your home or maybe you're somewhere out in a park watching on your cell phone, hey, get ready to pray this with us right now as well. All right, everybody, I want you to bow your heads. Let's close our eyes and say these words out loud together. Come on, everybody, join in and encourage them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. I give you all of my heart and all of my life. Come into my heart. Be my Lord and my Savior. Forgive me my sin of everything I've ever done wrong. Cleanse me of my past and give me a brand new future with you, Lord Jesus. Fill me now with your Holy Spirit. And let it be known that from this day on, that I am a Christian. I'm saved. I'm headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah. Now, I want to get some stuff in your hands. We want to help you and encourage you. You know, when you have a baby at the hospital, you don't leave the baby there and say, hey, kid, hope you do all right. We'll see you maybe, right? What do? You take that baby home with you. You nourish it. You take care of it and help raise it up into maturity, okay? We want to do that with you. You're brand new. You're born again. So you're our spiritual babies, all right? You got a new family in the place today, and we want to take care of you and encourage you and love you. All right, so right over here to my right, your left, this is Pastor Joel waving at you. He's going to give you some free information, some free literature, talk to you about some programs and some friends we have here in the church we want to connect you with. It'll take like a couple of minutes, and then he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you, okay? So you guys will just follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah. God is so good. Amen.